ekena chakrena ratasya gatir bhavet. With one wheel, the chariot cannot go, cannot move. Evam purushakarena vinam daivam na siddhyati. Likewise, without the self-effort, that destiny which we talk about, we cannot meet it. Only those who work, only those who put efforts, only those who are sincere and striving, they alone meet their true destiny. All others are like the chariot with one wheel, which will not go anywhere. It will stay where it is, where it was. Therefore, it's a great combination. This world is a great combination of divine grace and human effort. And one without the other cannot fulfill itself. Divine grace, it cannot fulfill itself without human effort. Human effort cannot fulfill itself without divine grace. Like two hands, they must come together. Like two eyes, they must see together. Like two ears, they must hear together. The two legs, they must walk together. Only the coming together of these two is the divine destiny. So, as the times are, so it should be our response. And that response is the test of one's character, how one responds to the situations in life. Situations will come, dvaita, all kinds. But how you respond by establishing yourself in advaita will define whether you have won or lost the battle. Outside you, it is dvaita. There is difficulty and there are easy things. There are pleasurable things, pleasant things, and there are those which are unpleasant and painful too. There are things that make you happy and those that bring sorrow. All the dvaita can be dealt with easily if you have responded from the state of advaita. If you are also in dvaita, outside is also dvaita, then there is absolute confusion. It's like two eyes seeing two different things. A patient went to a doctor and said, "Doctor, I'm always seeing two. Must be a drunkard. I'm always seeing two. Can you please help me how to cure my eyes?" He said, "Which one should I treat first amongst the two?" He said. So doctor is also seeing two and patient is also seeing two. How is it possible for the doctor to treat the patient? Unless doctor sees only one, then he can define which is the illusion and which is the real patient. In fact, there is nothing second. There is only one on the other side too. All other things are our illusions, imaginations. The two exist, but there is only one. However, the world that it has been designed this way, dvaita, and our understanding, our response is based on this illusory second in the world. So there is only one. However, if we don't develop this advaita bhava, eka bhava, how are we going to respond to this world which is dual? Pleasures and pains, sorrows, happiness, gains, losses, good, bad, happy times, sad times. This is the way world has been designed, like day and night. However, we only, if we establish ourselves in that advaita bhava, in eka bhava, where we see everything clearly, then only we can respond to this world in the right way. If we see two instead of one there, how are we going to respond? Whom to shoot? Arjuna will ask, "I see two instead of one." Which way to shoot the arrow? Where is the response? You cannot afford to see two. You see only one, then only you can respond to the world. So when times are these, when a patient lands up at the door of the hospital, or gates of the hospital, and you have to respond. If you see the patient as other from you, he is somebody else, I am somebody else, I have no relation with that patient, the patient has no relationship with me, why do I bother? Suppose it was your own child, you think COVID would have stopped you, you think anything would have stopped you on earth for that matter. Would you not have moved mountains to make sure that your child gets what it needs at that moment, however desperate it might be? That's all it is. When we are established in this advaita bhava, when we see everyone as our own, not different from us, when, or you say, I am devotee and I see divine in everything, in me and also in the patient who is knocking on the door, this advaita will give you the courage to go ahead and do what needs to be done. It will not allow you to see that needy as somebody who is different from you, different from the very purpose of your life, different from the very God whom you worship, different from the very idea of the God whom you worship. That also is me. That also is a part of me. That also is a reflection of me. That courage wisdom gives to work with devotion. Work, worship, wisdom. If you don't have wisdom, your work will not find its meaning. It won't find its purpose. Knowledge without action is useless. Action without knowledge is dangerous. It may be leading you somewhere else, all your action. You don't know which direction you're heading, which way is Chikbalapur, and you started off. Action has started, no direction. Only speed, no velocity. Where will it go? You don't know where you're going. So knowledge, that is wisdom. Wisdom means seeing everyone as one's own self. That's when love all, serve all is possible. Otherwise, it will remain a nicely worded quote, proudly repeated and gleefully printed and boastfully preached. Love all, serve all will not find its true meaning unless we establish ourselves in that idea of oneness. Only that person who sees one, yasmin sarvani bhutani atmaiva bhudvijanataha, Ishavasya tells us, all that is around us, all the beings are born of the same Atman. Atman only has become all this. I only have become many. Eko bahusyam. Only such a person will respond to the need. If they see that as different from this, then courage won't come. This Upanishads, they exhort us to be abhi, abhi, abhi. Be fearless, they call it. This is the call of Upanishad. Be fearless. How can we be fearless if you think the other person is a danger? Or we can be destroyed? If these kind of ideas of illusions are there, where is the question of becoming fearless? It's not possible. Not possible to be fearless in this world unless you see the oneness. Can you be afraid of your own self? In the dark, in the mirror, you see yourself by chance. You get scared because you thought that is somebody else. Switch on the light, you see, oh, this is you only in the mirror. There is only a mirror. There is no two. Only one with a reflection there. That is why there is nothing to fear. Immediately fear disappears. Otherwise you thought some thief or somebody has broken into the house. But you realize, no, it was a mirror and it's my own reflection. So there is nothing to fear. In fact, you'll stand there and set your hair and also write and go. Boys get in front of a mirror, that's it. Their hairstyle. And women get in front of the mirror, forget that. They'll not come back after that. I was going in New York or somewhere we had been. A huge tower and lot of floors. And the lift has to go all the way up. And they had put mirrors in the lift. So I asked them, this is not a dressing room. Why are there mirrors in the lift? They said, Swami, people get bored because the lift is too slow. It's an old lift, takes a long time to go. So if you keep the mirror, they're busy, you know, doing themselves hair, do makeup. And women will pull out even a vanity bag and touch up here and there. So they don't realize how much time it has taken for the lift to go. In fact, if lift didn't go also, they won't realize. Started with the zero floor, 10 minutes inside the lift, you didn't even realize that you're still on the zero floor. Lift opens, you come out, and then you realize, oh, I'm still here. Mirror. When you see that is also you, you start appreciating everything. That soul is Advaita Vedanta. All that Upanishads are teaching, calling, exhorting. Just one idea. Consider everything as you. Consider all as you. Aham Brahma, Sarvam Brahma. Everything is Sarvam, Kalvidam Brahman. All this is divine. All this is God. Where do I worship God? Worship in everyone. Tamatmastham. In your own self, you worship that divine. When that idea gets firmly established into you, Vedanta Vijnana Sunishchitartha. Sunishchita means completely convinced about it. Not just Nishchita, Sunishchita. Perfectly, completely, entirely convinced with the idea that there is no other. There is nobody other than you in this world. And therefore, you must respond in the way it is needed to them. That soul should drive your life. It's not an effort. it's an effortless response. Because you just know it is you, it is your own self in the other form, and you must do what it needs at that moment. That is the idea of Vedanta. So without Vedanta, this idea of being able to truly, truly love everyone without any conditions, without any expectations, and be able to serve everyone, put yourself at risk, in the sense the physical self at risk, for the sake of another physical self to be saved, will not be a question at all. It's an effortless response. It will just happen. Why? Because you just see yourself. Your hand gets cut. Do you think twice, should I bandage it or should I leave it? Immediately the other hand goes bandage. Because it's just one. It's just one. This idea of the Indian philosophy, that everything is one, that alone can give one the courage, the resilience, the abilities, the agility, to quickly respond. Everything, all ideas are embedded in this one idea. That all is one. All is one. And that is the idea of Vedanta, which is shouting from the mountaintop. Every single Upanishad, every single Rishi, every single sloka, deep down somewhere finds its roots in the same idea. All is one, all is one, all is one. There are no two. So don't delude yourself, don't get confused. Everything is one, everything is one. The moment we start looking at the world from this angle, this viewpoint, life becomes effortless. There is no decision making, there is no question, there are nothing to answer. Everything is known as the back of your palm, as they say. Everything is known. What needs to be done, when it needs to be done, how it needs to be done, where it needs to be done, why it needs to be done. These are no more questions. The questions don't exist after that. Only answers exist. Questions don't exist because you have established yourself in this one true idea that everything is one. And we simply say, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Do you think it is realizable so easily? One Kutumbakam only, we are not able to stay properly with four people inside. Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, we have to realize the great Indian idea. Aya nijaha parovetti ganana lagu chetasam. The limited people, limited-minded thing, they are different, we are different. These belong to me and those are not mine. Udara charita naam to Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. The one who thinks udara charita means one who has the broad mind. In the sense, the one who has the right mind, correct mind, good mind, samanaska, who sees oneness, whose mind is purified with devotion, with selfless service. For him, the wisdom shines. Prakashante mahatmanah. It just shines in the mind of those who have become pure through several selfless actions, through devotion. These are the methods to purify the mind. The wisdom comes naturally and shines in such a mind. He doesn't have to put effort to gain wisdom. Wisdom is always there. It gets revealed. That is the idea of Upanishad. And the one who understands this oneness only will be able to do everything that is needed, whenever needed, however it's needed, by whomever it is needed. There's no questions asked, no answers to be thought about. It's just a natural response. That is the life of a Vedantin. That is the life of that who sees one. That is the life that we all have to lead. Why? Because we are so convinced, Sunishchita, we are so convinced it's all one. It's the same in all. So whomever I serve the same divine self. Whomever I also hurt the same divine self. Is nama rupa vihaya. This nama rupa is the confusion in this whole place. If you remove the name and form, we are all the same. Because of these external covers and the identification of a name and form, we think we are all different. We are all jewels made of the same gold. We are all pots made of the same clay. We are all beings made of the same Brahman. And therefore, there is no two here. The one who sees two, dual mind is half blind, they say. But I'll say it's full blind is. If he sees two, he's full blind. Because he sees, that's why your operation says, ya pashyati, sa pashyati. The one who sees that oneness alone sees. Otherwise, he does not see at all. He's blind. Though he sees, he's blind. He's not seeing. So the one who is established in this idea of Upanishad, the oneness of everything, how is it that he will have to think, worry twice? No questions asked. It's just an effortless living for such a person. Everything is one. Nobody needs to tell him. Nobody needs to ask him. Nobody needs to advise him. He knows. Why? Because he just sees himself in everyone. And that's how it is possible to love all, and that's how it is possible to serve all. Take whichever way. Therefore, I am so insistent that you must put some efforts to go within and realize that idea of oneness, not lip service, no talks, no empty talks. It is a nice thing to talk. But by talking, we don't realize anything. By talking about food, we don't feed ourselves. Stomach is not full. We must realize ourselves as the truth. And to that person alone, it's given that he will be always happy. Tamatmastam yena nupashyanti dhira, he said just now. Tesham sukham shashvati. Tesham shanti shashvati. They alone can be happy, they alone can be peaceful in all the chaos that is around. Whatever is happening around in the world, however difficult, however testing the times are, however desperate the situations are, still that one person who is established in this idea that there is only one will not be affected. He will act in this world as needed. He will not have to worry, he will not have to fear, he will not have to think twice. Because he established in this idea, everything is one. All are mine, all are me only. They are not different. Sarva bhuteshu chatmanam, sarva bhutani chatmani. All are me, I am all. This idea of Vedanta, once firmly established in the mind of the person, will definitely make the person fearless, compassionate. All the virtues, sarve guna, all the virtues will be in that person who understands this fundamental truth and experiences it, not just talks about it. Talking will not take us too far. Now, vacho nivartante aprapya manasa. It cannot be understood by speeches. It cannot be comprehended by the mind. It is beyond that. Experiences alone will make us courageous enough, fearless, responsive. Put all the good qualities that you can think of in the dictionary in that person who alone knows, who knows that everything is one. There is only one, there are no two. That's why this Vedantic study, to some extent, you must put some efforts. So beautiful Veda, I was just, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, seems the demons, the men and the gods, they approach Prajapati and ask him, instruct us, O dear father. He created everybody, so they approach him. And he says, Tebhyam, to all of them, he says, what does he say? One aksharam. Uvacha. What is one aksharam? Da, he says. Da. That's all. Rest is for them to understand. I speak in too many words, yet people don't understand. Imagine that Prajapati. Of to all the three, he gave only one instruction. Da. So he asked the gods, have you understood? The gods said, yes, I have understood. Then he asked the demons, have you understood? He said, yes, we have understood too. He asked the men, have you understood? Yes, we have understood too. What have you understood? God said, Da means Damayati. I have to exercise control, self-control, because I have too many powers in my hand and I can misuse them. If I lose track, if I lose balance, it can be destructive. You have given me so many powers. Dama. I have to control myself. That is the Da I have understood. When the men approached and he told Da, and he asked, what did you understand of this Da? He said, for me, Dana, charity is what I must do, because men are born greedy. There is never enough. Somewhere I read, the desires of the men are infinite and the resources are finite. Thus was born economics. The subject was born only because of this one reason, that man's desires are limitless. Whereas the resources available to fulfill those desires are very limited. So all the economics in the world. It's infinite desires. Therefore, control your desires. That is the second thing. Dana means what you don't need, beyond that, give it away. Help others. Your energy, your time, your resources, your wealth, your any talent, anything that is more than what you require must be used for the service of others. That is the idea of men. And the demons who approach, you know how demons are. I asked one lady, how are your two children? Oh, those two are devils, she said. Devils. So she must have a good, fair idea of what demons are like in her two children. So of course, she said it out of love only, but imagine the kind of characters those two must be. They're twins, best part. If one makes a mistake, other will get blamed, one can escape, you know, blaming the other. So difficult for the mother to identify. Anyways, that is called, so da, what did you understand? He asked the demons. And demon said, daya, because we are cruel by nature. We harm, we hurt people, that is our nature. Therefore, by nature, we are bad, cruel. Therefore, for us, daya is the meaning. So, Akashvani happened. Da, 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 he said, Akashvani, strongly. Damyati, daya, dayadvam, and dana, datta. These are the three words the Akashvani spoke. Damyati, datta, dayadvam. These are the three virtues that we have to follow. And where are these gods, demons, and men? They're all in us. They're not outside us. Sometimes we are all gods, sometimes we are devils, sometimes we are just humans with our frailties, our weaknesses. So these three values of Damayati, this control over ourselves, daya, compassion for others, and datta, charity to others. This is a spiritual life. This is a spiritual life. So Upanishads are not just there talking philosophically, realize yourself as one, the consciousness. They also are telling us practically how to lead our lives in the world. There are times when we have tremendous powers within ourselves. All powers lie within. That is what Vivekananda said. You are infinitely powerful. So we can make mistakes also. All the wrong that is happening in the world, some demons are not coming and doing it here like in old times. These are men only. Educated men, scientists, businessmen. They are the ones who are the nuisance today. Why? Because they are behaving like the powers that they have, the intellectual powers, they're misusing it. So for them, Upanishad says, you have too much power. Exercise control, restrain, dhamma, follow dhamma. And there are times when we are just humans, you know, our greed, the want for more and more and more. 6%, 6 people in the world control 50% of world's wealth. And I'm sure after COVID, most of the world's wealth, they only will be controlling because the rest have lost everything, whatever they have had. Where is that? There are people who are hungry, there are people who are struggling, there are people who cannot afford a day's meal. Forget this kind of high-end treatment that is beyond their scope. A simple education they cannot afford. 2 square meals a day they don't have. And today, after this COVID situation, the newspaper I read, the kind of migrants and their issues. Numbers are every day growing. 8-10 crore people without job, without food, without home, and exposed to such risk of that virus and the heat, sweltering heat of the summer, walking on the roads barefoot to their own villages with the hope 300, 200, 1200 kilometers also people are walking. Some are dying on the way. And yet there is one part of the world which is only trying to maximize their profits in this. That is why I got so irritated with this online education people. They want to pump all the money, capital into online education now because they understood this contactless life is going to be the way forward for a long time. Parents are scared to send their children to schools, not our schools, but general schools in a government school. We don't know what facilities are there. And here are a set of capitalists who are trying to, like vultures, waiting for the man to fall. That's why we said, no, this cannot be. No, it cannot be so cheap. Humanness is not so cheap. Daya, dana, dhamma, where are these values? I know we can make some, he knows he can make a profit here, but should he make a profit out of this? Should he make a profit out of a dying child, a helpless mother, a struggling father? Should humanity come down to this level because of greed? That is why Prajapati told humans, dana, datta, remember this as your virtue. You must stick to this virtue forever. That is datta. And the demon in us, cruelty. We hurt people, we harm people, we misbehave, we trouble people. We are rude to them. We cause hurt, harm, our anger, our frustrations, our irritations, our disappointments, they all show up. The man is very good at office, you know. Somebody asks, how is that your... All that he'll take out at home. His wife and children will suffer. Because in office, he cannot open the mouth, especially in these times when you can lose job with a drop of a hat. Everybody's finding ways to cut jobs. All the anger, frustration, disappointments, they come out as cruelty. Cruel words, cruel thoughts, cruel actions, cruel emotions. That demon comes out, you know, scratch and the beast comes out. That's what Vivekananda said. And what happens to them? So then also Upanishad goes and says what? You must practice daya. So daya, dhamma, datta. Three cardinal values, three Ds you can say. So simple, so easy. In our life, if we follow a little of these Upanishads, even Vedantic level, you go to the next. But even basic, practical, social level, there are messages. Tena tyaktena bunjita, we heard from Ishavasyam. What a message. Consume, enjoy the world, but with a sense of sacrifice. Sacrifice first, take later. Simple. Why? Ishavasyam idam sarvam. All are the same. All are divine. That's why do that. Not because of any other reason. Simply because everything is divine. How can you harm divine? How can you not love divine? So that idea Upanishads are speaking from, that Lord's mountaintop, as they say. From there these Upanishads are giving a call. Shrunvante Vishwa Amrutasya Putra. Shrunvantu, listen, Vishwa, all of you. You are Amrutasya Putra, you are children of immortality. Wake up. Uttishta Jagrata. That is the call of the Upanishads. The call of the Indian wisdom. And it's valid. It was valid 10,000 years ago. It's valid today. It will be valid forever. Everything, all science, mathematics, commerce, the way business is done, the way medicine works, everything will undergo a change in the next even 50 years, by 100 years. New technologies, new methods. This wisdom will not undergo any change. This is timeless, eternal, shashvata. And the one who has caught hold of this wisdom, he will respond correctly. He will respond to every situation in life, as Srinivas just said. Anybody, if the children are endowed with that kind of wisdom, they'll have clarity. Life will throw many challenges, many situations, small, big, easy, difficult. In all those situations, this wisdom alone will give us the understanding, right understanding, how to go about it. Otherwise, we will lose our way in the winds and the storms and of the world, which will just come and uproot us. Unless we are firmly rooted in the idea of this Vedanta, firmly established in this idea of oneness, completely aware of our reality, there is no other way. That is why I keep on repeating, Nanya Pantha Ayanaya Vidyate. No other path. If there was another path, easier path, even a longer path, I would have suggested you. But there is no other path. If there was a choice, I could have discussed. There is no choice. This is the only one. This is the only path. Therefore, we must take to this path and not fool ourselves thinking there can be another easier way out of this whole thing. No, there is no other way, no easier way. This is the way, this is the only way to realize that you are one with everything, and that realization alone can help us respond correctly in our lives. Whatever be the situation, small, big, look at the Upanishadic wisdom. So practical, at the same time so eternal, so permanent, so lofty. Everything is there in these Upanishads. Unfortunately, other than this, we have been learning and teaching everything else. If you spend some time on these sacred scriptures, it will do a lot good to you. It will do a lot good to you and to everybody else around. The satarati, satarati, lokastam tarayanti. You will be redeemed and you will redeem 10 others also. The whole world you will redeem because of your own redemption. Because you know the way out. They were taking us to Venice from some place, I think Padua to Venice somewhere. Padua to Venice. Those Venice merchants were there in those days, very rich. So they took us to a big palace, showing that this is how the palaces of these merchants were. They were like king's palaces. Very influential, affluent. And there was one of these maze, you know. You know, have you seen the maze? So there was this maze of made of in a garden made of the hedge, and everybody wanted to try out. Nobody has ever used that maze before, but why not? So everybody was there inside the maze. Getting inside was very exciting. All wanted to get inside, like that Abhimanyu. Get inside. I know what to do. All got inside. Can't even see who is in which lane where. Everybody's, I'm here. Where? I'm here. Here means where? North, south, east, west, up, down. No idea. Lost in the maze. Everybody is shouting, help me out of this maze. Mess it is now. Nobody knows how to come out of it. See, we are all here only next to each other, but we can't see each other. We cannot know the direction. We don't know which way to come out. Which way we came in also, we don't know. How to get out? Then somebody, there's a tower in the center, fortunately, or intelligently, whichever way. And on that tower, there are people standing. And they are guiding each one. Now take a right now, now take a left, and then take a U-turn, and then come from there, left, right. Finally, we were out. Iha samsare bahu dustare, kripaya pare pahi murare. Oh God, Lord, you alone can take us out from this maze of life. We get inside very excitedly. It looks very interesting, adventurous, but it hardly, in a little time, we realize what it is. By our own accord, we cannot come out of it. Nevertheless, if Lord says from the mountaintop, from the tower, take a right, you must take a right, isn't it? If you stand there and say, no, I am your responsibility, you'll airlift me from here. It's not possible. So, Purusha Karyena, your efforts to realize this, and Daiva, God's grace to help you come out of it. Both have to come together to realize and to be redeemed. God will keep shouting from the tower, take a right, take a left. You don't want to move. Instead, you misunderstand. Instead of right, you take a left. Left, you take a right. And what happens at the end? You're still stuck in that maze. Punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. That's what it says. Punaravartante. Keep on coming back again and again and again in the same maze. And again, you don't know how to come out of it. Because it's not given to you to find it out all by yourself. With the help of the divine alone, one can come out of it. The divide, you find him in a form outside, or you find him as a formless inside, whichever way you find him. That divine alone can lead us out of this mess, this maze of life. And that is the lesson we have to remember. And once we are out, there is no fear. Tatra ko moha ka shoka. Where is the fear? Where is the sorrow for a person who sees oneness, they say? Na vijugupsate. He doesn't get afraid, he doesn't get perturbed, he doesn't hate anybody. Matva dhiro na shochati. Knowing that the dhira never suffers. All these are Upanishadic statements. By now 4 or 5 Upanishads are over. So I'm telling you, from all Upanishads, this is the method. They will start with the storyline somewhere, end in the same final moral. But how wonderful are these wonderful wisdom was at our disposal for so long, and we have turned our heads away. And that is why we are suffering today. Unfortunately, the Veda Upanishads have been understood only so much. Karma Kandis. They are only interested in, by road they go, without thinking what is the significance, meaning, reason, nothing. That is the reason why these Upanishadic studies, Vedas, have declined. Why? Because people did not find justice in it. The Brahmins held the knowledge so dear to their chest that nobody else had an access to it. Because there was no written scriptures. Everything has to be told and repeated. So all the knowledge is inside the head of that teacher. And other caste, other people, women, they were all deprived of this knowledge. And that is the curse of our culture. Where some selfish people, they kept the knowledge to themselves and decided as they wanted, ruled, controlled, influenced the societies. And everybody else was at their mercy. But today the times have changed. Today there is no such thing. As long as you are Brahmanishtha, you have faith in that divine, Brahma para, you are devoted to the divine, and Brahmanveshanamana, you have the mind, you have the spirit of investigation, inquiry, who it is, how do I experience that, enough, you are eligible to know Brahman, to know the truth, to know the Vedantic truths. And that effort should come from your side. that effort to know, that eagerness to know, that should come from your side. Otherwise, instead of da-da-da, you'll end up doing da-da-da, destroying everything. As somebody was telling, the biggest problem with the youth, the generation today, they're becoming atheists. Every day, the biggest conversion is not to another religion. Conversion to atheist is the biggest conversion. Why? Because the religions have become so, a kind of, you see, dogmatic. They have become so narrow. There are no answers for some of their questions. So they don't understand. An animal welfare agency fellow, why will he believe in our Yagni Agas? He'll say, you people are killing animals. Why should it be appreciated? He's right. One side you say ahimsa, other side you're killing. So these kind of ritualistic idea has killed our religion, killed our culture, and dissuaded, you know, demotivated people to pursue this. But the Vedanta, the Upanishads, the essence, the knowledge part of it, not the action of the Karma Kanda, but the knowledge of the Jnana Kanda, is the hope. And that, if you people pick up very quickly, put some effort, it can, first it will redeem you. That is the first beneficiary is you. Second beneficiary is everybody else who comes in touch with you. And your life, action, thought, everything will reflect that wisdom. Whatever is there in the tank only will come out of taps, isn't it? If your tank is full of Upanishadic wisdom, taps will only deliver that. Your mouth, eyes, ears, nose, hands, legs, everything will only act upon that ultimate wisdom of oneness. And that alone will redeem us. There is no other way. Nanya Panta. If there is another way, there was another hope. But there is no other way, there is no other hope. This is the only hope. And the earlier we pick up this, knowing very well that this is the only and nothing else, the better it is for the humanity. Therefore, this message of Vedanta should go out, and you people should be the messengers of this. Not just by preaching, by living that Vedantic truth. It should reflect in your thoughts, words, actions. Every single day, every single time, a decision has to be made. It should be made from that highest Vedantic wisdom of oneness. That should guide. Our mind should not interfere. Our intellect should not disturb us. The Atman, the higher self, the consciousness should be our guiding force in every decision of our life. Then alone we will be able to lead a fulfilling human life on earth. Otherwise our lives are unfulfilled. With every other achievement, it is unfulfilled. The only achievement that is fulfilling is the achievement of this vision of oneness, this understanding and experience of oneness. Everything becomes fulfilling. What gives Swami so much of courage to go on doing these things? What gives him so much of motivation to go on saving so many people? Who are they? How do they belong? At least you are somewhere in part of the institution, you are my headache. I can think like that. What about those who come from anywhere, no name, no address, no relation? What is the relation? This is the relation. We are related in Atman. Atman Neva Budvijanata. All this is Atman only. Therefore I must help. Therefore I must serve. Therefore I must care. Why? Because it's the same thing. Just the way I will care for my aching tooth, I will have to care for that person's pain and suffering too. Why? Because we feel the oneness. It's not an intellectual understanding. It's an experiential living. Every moment you experience that, yes, I feel one with the other person. And therefore I love them. Therefore I have to do something for them. And they are miserable in their ignorance or in their sorrow of whatever kind. It is my, not even a duty, it's love. Love without duty it is. It just flows. Effortless. Incessant. Spontaneous. Because I'm living in that truth. That all are one. All are one. Yes, forms and names are different, but these are just illusions. Behind them, the truth is one. Truth is one, whoever it is. And this seva purifies our mind, develops our understanding. Bhakti steadies our mind, helps us focus on this thought, so that jnana can reveal itself, since it's already there. It's not coming from somewhere and entering us. It's always been there, but covered in layers and layers and layers and layers of dust and rust. So that is the only idea of the Upanishad. But these times will not come back again. That is one thing that you must keep in your mind. Never again will I sit down like this day after day after day, explaining, asking, revealing and answering. these times will not come down. Very soon, times are changing. The less speech, more silence. Those are the times which are coming very soon. So you have to find your answers in your own silence using these sessions as your guide, how to decipher. All that is going to change very soon. Enough has been spoken, enough has been heard. Very little has been acted upon. That is what is coming to now. So these are more or less the last series of discourses and lectures. Of that, intermittently, when as and when there is a need. Otherwise, there is no need to speak. The rest you have to understand. You have to move from Vaikari to Madhyama to Para. And how important it is, you, whether you believe it or not, I was sitting in the morning in the balcony there, and I saw these two beings descending from the mountain on the opposite side, because the balcony faces the mountain. They're descending like this. I thought, who are they? Looks like they're Ashwini Kumaras. They generally are like a pair, they're twins. Are they Ashwini Kumaras? I was thinking. And they came and just in the air outside the balcony, they were just suspended in the air. And they had some flowers in their hands. And they poured the flowers like this as a greeting. And I asked them, who are you? Are you Ashwini Kumaras? They said, no. Who are you? I asked. He said, we are Vanadevatas. We live here only in these mountains. We both are brothers, twins. That's why we look alike. And we have been here for a long, long time in these hills. What makes you come here? No, we are seeing the kind of activities that are going on in this place. Young men are learning Upanishads and great knowledge of this text. We really are very keen that you should allow us also to come and attend. I said, what will you do by knowing? He said, no, we have been always eager. There have been so many rishis here. I asked, how many rishis are there in these mountains? He told 898, that's the number he gave, like on district survey. 898 rishis are there in this. Oh, who are they? What are they doing here? They have been here for thousands of years. And they are meditating. They are always lost in themselves. And they like this place. So they are all they dwell on these mountains, all the hills in the forests. What is your role? I asked. He told, we protect these forests. We protect these rishis. We protect and we restrict any unwanted, you know, infiltration into these places. But nowadays he started lamenting, this materialistic world has become too strong and the spirituality of this place is declining. But there is a great hope. When we came here and we saw all this good is happening, we have been watching you for a long time and we really like it because all these things are growing over here. I said, how old have you been? How long have you been? Then he told, I think we have been here for 8,500 years or so, like that, he said. Because he was calculating in human lifetime. See, their timing is different. There is no time there. So, but to help me understand how long it has been, told 8,500 years, he said. That is how long we have been here. In fact, he said, we were the first to, his achievement he's telling, we were the first to stop the construction of a road through the Nalakadrenali village, he said. They came and opposed, he says. I said, how? He told, not now. Long back a king was here. He was trying to make road through this forest, through the hills. That time we only came and opposed. In that, they died. And that after that, there have been two spirits and dwelling in this place. That's what they told. In that fight with the king to oppose the construction of road through forest corridor, they had fought back. And that's how they died. And they have become two devatas or whatever, Kumaras. And they have been living here since then. And they showed me two marks on their hands. The one fellow's hand, left hand, and one fellow's hand is right hand, like just like mirror images. I said, what is this? He said, this is how these rishis identify us, who is who, because we look alike otherwise. So I said, this is when there was a forest fire, we got burnt in those times. There was a forest fire, we got burnt, our hands got burnt. And so that's why I have mark on this hand, he has mark on the other hand. That's how these rishis recognize such. And they are telling they are all here. I said, what is that you want from us? He said, I don't want anything. I'm just happy to tell you that we are happy that so much of spiritual activity is going on here. And he also told these rishis are waiting because they know a lot more rishis are going to come here. Lot more good people, noble people, spiritual aspirants are going to come to this place. So they're all waiting. They like the company of such good people. And he said, then I asked him, now business, what will you do for us? And he said, we will provide enough water and fertility to the land here, he said. That is their contribution. We'll provide enough water, he said. Because this was all dry land, but today we have enough water. We don't have to buy water. Look at the rains that are incessantly coming. Muddanalli was not like this. 6 years back, students used to have bath once in 4 days or something like that, I've heard, in the name of water scarcity. Whether that was the truth or otherwise, but that was the truth. Today, plenty of water, greenery, rich flora, fauna, so many peacocks, all these things, how it is happening? Some divine grace on this land. Why? Because divine activities, divine people. And therefore, all these beings are here to support. He told these two things very clearly as they were leaving. Last, I asked him, so what will you do for us? He said, we will make the land fertile and provide enough water because so many people are going to come here, they should have water. That is their contribution, they said. Look at the whole universe is looking towards this place. And these beings who have been there for thousands of years are so happy with these good, auspicious tidings. How much more should we be responsible? Should we respond to this noble idea of redeeming ourselves, learning the truth? How much more effort we should put? Just divine grace won't do it. Human effort is a must on this path. Both human effort and divine grace together will find fulfillment. One without the other will not work. All divine grace, no human effort, zero results. All human efforts, no divine grace, zero efforts, zero result. Together, complete result, 100%. Purnamadam, Purnamidam. Therefore, it is very, and I told these are the best times. These times will not come back easily again. These are the best times. In this adversity, this is an opportunity for all. Use this time. Thresholds are low. It's easier to cross over now to the other side. It is easier. This is the very, very opportune time. If you put little effort also, swalpam apyasya, little effort also, it will yield great results. This is that time. And therefore, utilize it well without wasting a single moment in idle pursuits. Just keep yourself focused and achieve what you have got to achieve. And as he said, once you achieve that, you will just know what to do with your life, how to go about with your life. Every guidance, every decision, everything will be inspired by that Brahman, by that divinity which is within. How long will you listen to my instructions? You have to find a way. This is the way. And there is no other way. This is the only way. To find divinity, realize, and thereby respond. That is the only way.